carrier sensing multiple axis with collision detection. So it is carrier sensing multiple axis with collision detection. So assuming that we are having some stations, like this is the station A, this is the station B, this is the station C, this is the station D, and all these four stations are connected through a channel. Okay, so in case of carrier sensing multiple axis, any station can transmit the data at any time, right? But before before sending the data, it has to sense at its end, right? And you can see these are the points where these stations are connected. So before sending the data, for example, if A wants to send the data, then A will sense at its own node. A cannot sense at others' node. A will sense at its own node that whether there is some other station which is already transmitting the data or not. Okay, so you can say it like this: any station in CSMA CD can transmit the data at any time, but before sending the data, they have to sense the carrier that whether some other station is sending or not, that whether some other station is already sending the data or not, sending its own data packets or not, its own data packets or not. Okay, now second point is here, because any station can check the data, it is carrier sensing multiple access. First of all, carrier sensing means every station can sense the carrier at its own end, that is at its own node. And multiple access means multiple stations can access the can try to access this channel simultaneously, right? And then we have something called as a collision detection. Collision detection means these carriers can sense whether there is a collision in the network or not. Okay, now for example, assuming that station A wants to send the data, so station A is sending the data, and at the same time station D is also sending the data. Okay, if they are sending the data simultaneously, it can happen that here we are having some kind of collision between station A and station D, and after collision, a collision signal will be sent in both the directions. This is the collision signal. Okay, so other stations can check in the carrier that there is a collision signal or not. If there is a collision signal, then they will know that there is already collision in the network. Okay, and second is, in case of carrier sensing multiple access, we don't send any kind of acknowledgement. So you can say there will be no acknowledgements which are sent. Okay, so here assuming that in the same scenario, let station A wants to send the data and station B wants to send the data at the same time, and station A sensed that the carrier is free, and station B also sensed that the carrier is free. Now assuming that station A and B, the both sending the data, started sending the data simultaneously. Okay, what do I mean to say by this is, assuming that we are having the following scenario: this is the station A, this is the station B, this is the station C, and this is the station D, and all these four stations are connected with the carrier. So this is the carrier. Okay, now assuming that here station A wants to send the data, and station D also wants to send the data at the same time. So before sending the data, they will sense at their end whether whether there's already someone sending the data or not. Now they can sense that still no one is sending the data right now. So they will first of all transmit their data packet here. It will also transmit its data packet here. Now they will start sending the data like this. They will start sending the data like this. Okay. And because they are sending the data simultaneously, obviously here in this scenario we can have some kind of collision. So here this data packet from station A wants maybe colliding with the data packet which came from the station D. And as soon as this data packets are colliding, so there will be collision signal which is sent in both the direction, and this collision signal will be received by station A as well as the station D. Both of them will be receiving the collision signal simultaneously. Okay, now if the collision signal is sent simultaneously, then how can the station A and D be sure that this collision signal which they have received is because of their own data packet? Okay, let us assume how can this happen. Assuming that this is the station A, this is B, C, D and E. Consider this scenario. In this scenario, assuming that station A wants to send the data to the station B, okay, station C wants to send the data to station E, and station E wants to send the data to station A. C wants to send to station A, and E wants to send to station A. Station E wants to send to station C. Okay, now what can happen? Station A will sense that carrier is free. Station B, C will sense the carrier is free. Station E will sense the carrier is free. Then all of them will transmit the data simultaneously. And assuming that station A already transmitted the already sent the data to packet B, and station C and station E, the data they are sending, now these two datas are colliding. Now if they are colliding, then obviously collision signal will be sent in both the direction. Now you can clearly see it can happen that station A sent the data successfully to the station B, but still station A received the collision signal. Then how can station A be sure that the data packet which the station A has sent is already successfully delivered or not? Or you can say, how can A be sure that the collision signal which A has received is for its own data packet or it is for someone else's data packet? Okay, this is a confusion here because we are not having any kind of acknowledgement. Okay, so generally what happens is if you send the data and you get the acknowledgement, then you can be sure that the data is sent. Okay, but in case of CSMA CD, we do not have acknowledgement. Because it is used in the LAN protocols, and many LANs do not have acknowledgement mechanism. So we can say CSMA CD is mostly used in LAN. So you will not be having, you don't have any acknowledgement mechanism for LANs. Okay, so here, as I told you, in case of CD means the sender should detect the collision and find out if the data was delivered or not. Okay, so how can A be sure, or how can some other else, station can be sure that the data packet which it sent is the collision signal which it received is for its own data packet? How can they be sure? Okay, assuming that this is a scenario that we have four stations, station A, B, C, D, and station A wants to send the data to station D, and station D wants to send the data to station A. So they will transmit the data, and now they will start sending the data. Okay, now if there is a collision, and then A can only be sure the data is lost in the collision is his own data only if it is still transmitting the data and it got the collision signal. Okay, you can say station A can only be sure that the data which is lost in collision is his own data, his data, only if it is still transmitting the data, it is still transmitting the data, it is still transmitting the data, and it got back the collision signal, and it got back the collision signal, the collision signal. Okay, so for example, if A sending the data and station D sending the data, if both of them send the data at the same time and still station A is currently being transmitted, obviously if A received the collision signal, that means its own data packet will be colliding, because of collision its own data packet is corrupted. Okay, so if it is already sending the data and it is getting the collision signal, then the collision signal will also be colliding with its own data packet. So you can say station A can only be sure the data is lost in the collision is its own data only if it is still transmitting the data and got back the collision signal. Now what does it mean? It means that to detect collision, we have to make a data packet long enough that by the time collision signal comes back to A, then A is still having some data transmit, and then A can find out that their own data will be lost. Okay, so let me write it down. To detect collision, or you can say the implication of the above statement is that if the data packet size is long enough that by the time the collision signal comes back to A and A is still transmitting the data, then A can find out that its own data packet which is lost. Okay, you can say in worst case scenario A should keep on transmitting the data until A is sure that there is no collision. Okay, so let me explain it to you with this example. How can A be sure that its own data packet is collided or not? Now, for example, assuming that A wants to send the data to station D. Now, if A is first of all transmitting the data, after transmitting the data, A will propagate the data, that is TP. Okay, A will take the propagation time, that is TP. Now, if till A sent the data to the station number D, or the data packet did not receive to the end station number D, if in meanwhile there is some kind of collision, right, and during that time A is not transmitting the data, then A cannot be sure whether its own data packet is lost or not. But if there is a scenario when A is transmitting the data continuously, right, till the data packet received to this side, A is still transmitting the data, right? So data pack is sent, but A is still transmitting the data. And you can see in meanwhile, is someone else is sending the data, then A can be sure that its own data packet is collided. Its own data packet is collided. Okay. So obvious question is how much time should A transmit, for how long? So obvious question is for how long should A transmit. Okay, so assuming that this is the station A and this is the station B and they are connected with each other, and there's a distance of 1 minute between them, right? That means the propagation time is 1 minute. Okay, so if the propagation time is 1 minute, so then what will happen, assuming that this is A and B and their propagation time is 1 minute, A started sending the data at 10:00 a.m. where this is denoting hours, this is denoting minutes, and this is denoting seconds. At the same time, B is also trying to send the data. B also sending the data at 10:00, again hours, minutes, and seconds. Okay, now both of them started transmitting the data at time 10. Now A is transmitting the data to B, and B is transmitting the data to A, and here the data is traveling. TP is time is there. Okay, and if the both of them are sending the data simultaneously, and exact middle there will be a collision, this exact middle the data packet from A will be received, will be reaching at time 10:00:30. Okay, in the same way from B, this same data packet will be received at the time 00:30. That means at this time we'll be having a collision. Therefore, after this collision, A will get the collision signal. A will get the collision signal after 30 seconds, after 30 more seconds. Right, so because the time taken for this collision signal to reach to A will be again 30 seconds, because from A to this point it took 30 seconds to travel. From this point to A itself, it is going to take 30 seconds to travel. In the same way, if B's data packet collided at time and this time, then to reach this point, the data packet took 30 seconds, so the collision signal will also take 30 seconds. Okay, so you can see if there exists some kind of collision, then A will know about the collision only after total of 30 plus 30 seconds, which is equal to 1 minute, and 1 minute is TP. 1 minute is TP, or you can say propagation time. Okay, so you can say that therefore both A and B got the collision signal exactly after 1 TP time, that is 1 into propagation time. So exactly after 1 TP time, both of them will get the collision signal. Therefore you can say if for A and B to know that there is a collision, then this transmission time should be obviously greater than the propagation time. Okay, so we already know that in the previous slide we have seen that if A and B wants to know that there's a its own data packet is colliding, that means A have to transmit the data. If A is transmitting the data, and meanwhile A got the collision signal, that means A can be sure that its own data packet is collided. Now you can see here, if A is transmitting the data and it takes 1 TP time or 1 minute time from propagating the data from A to B, then if in the exact middle there is a collision, then A will get the collision signal only after 1 minute, or you can say TP time. Okay, so you can say TT should be greater than TP here in this case, but how long, or you can say how big the TT should be. There still exists a question, because they are giving you that lower bound is this, but what should be the upper bound to this? Okay, now let us case the most, you know, worst scenario, or you can say worst case scenario, is that if this is the A and this is B, and A and B are connected with each other. Now, assuming that A started, A sensed that there is no data in the network, so A started transmitting the data, and data started propagating. As soon as the data was just about to reach to B, B also sensed that the carrier is free, and B also transmitted data, and here they got a collision. Now, if here they'll get a collision, then the collision signal will be sent to A. As well as the collision signal will be sent to B. Now, here you can see if there's a TP time will be there for reaching the data packet from A to B, then again the collision signal will take TP time. Okay, so therefore you can say, the transmission time should at least be greater than TP. At least transmission time should be greater than 2 into TP in worst case. In worst case scenario. Okay, so we can say if we have to transmit the data, so if we have to transmit the data, the data packet for at least 2 into TP time, then how much data should we send? Now this is the question. Okay, so here you can see the relation is like this. The transmission time should be greater than or equal to 2 into TP. Okay, and we already know what is the transmission time. Transmission time is size of data packet, okay, upon bandwidth, that should be greater than 2 into TP. So therefore you can say size of data packet, S should be greater than 2 into TP multiplied by bandwidth. Okay, or you can say the length of the data packet in order to detect collision should be greater than 2 into TP multiplied by bandwidth. Okay, so you can there are different questions which are asked based on this. For example, they can say that propagation time is one like this. The propagation time is 10 milliseconds and the bandwidth of the network is 2 megabits per second. Then what should be the size of the data packet, or what should be the length of the data packet? Then you can easily find out the size or length of the data packet should be greater than 2 into TP. TP is given as 10 millisecond, 10 into 10 raised to power minus 3 seconds multiplied by bandwidth. Bandwidth is 2 megabits per second, that means 2 into 10 raised to power 6 bits per second. So here you can see it is 2 into 2 is 4, and you can, this is 10 raised to power 7 minus 10 raised to power 3 multiplied by 4 multiplied by 10 raised to power 4. Okay, so this much should be the length of the data packet, at least this much bits should be there. If I say in terms of bytes, that means you can divide by 3, 10 raised to power 3. Okay, so what if the data which we are sending is not of this much size? What if the data packet, which we are sending is not of this much time, that means it's not of size L, then what should happen? You can say in that case you can append the dummy bits. the dummy bits. Dummy bits are the bits which are not there, right? For example, assuming that you are chatting on Facebook and you are just sending hi. Now, if this hi message is not of this much size and you want this message to be delivered instantaneously, then obviously you have to append some extra or dummy bits to make it big, right? And that to make it big for at least this much size, and then you will be sending it. Okay, so now because of this, what do you think? What is the efficiency of CSMA CD? What is the efficiency of CSMA CD? Efficiency of CSMA CD. Okay, so in case of efficiency, you can see there is a probability of collision, because generally what we do in case of efficiency is, efficiency is always useful time upon total time. But in case of CSMA CD, the total time will increase, because sometimes it can happen that there is a collision, and if there is a collision, then obviously you can see we may lose the data packet and that time will not be useful. Okay, so if there is a collision, then at least 2 into TP time is wasted. 2 into TP time is wasted. Okay, because our packets get transmitted, then there might be a collision, and we can say let us say if after every C number of time, or after every C collision, you will be able to send one data packet. Then you can see, if this is the time slot, this is representing the time slot. First of all, to send one data, it is going to take 2 into TP time, then again 2 into TP time, then again 2 into TP time, then TT plus TP time, then again some time like this. Okay, again there is TT plus TP time. Okay, so here what we are saying by this is, this is 2 into TP time. So what I want to say by this is that before any successful transmission, there can be any number of collisions. Okay, here this is representing that it is a successful transmission, right? And these are representing there's a collision, and every time we are having a collision, we are going to waste 2 into TP time. So this is 2 into TP time, this is 2 into TP time, and this is 2 into TP time. So every time we are going to have a collision, we are going to waste this much time, and then again we can have a successful transmission. Okay, so this is representing a collision slot, or you can say it is also representing a contention slot. Collision or contention slot, both are same thing. Contention slot, and this is representing the time which is wasted by the collision or contention slot. Now we are saying, before making any successful transmission, we will be having C collisions, right? Or you can say we'll be having C collisions. This C can be given in terms of probability, or it can be given in terms of numbers. Or you can say, if I say before making one successful transmission, you can have on an average of 6 collisions, right? That means you will be having 6 into 2 into TP time, right? And you can convert this 6 into probability, right? You can easily convert it to probability. So you can say, what is the efficiency you are getting? Efficiency is TT upon C into 2 into TP plus TT plus TP, where this is representing the time for a successful transmission, and this is representing the time wasted in collision. This is representing the time wasted in case of collision. Okay, so this is the efficiency of CSMA CD. Okay, now let us try to find if there is any formula which we can derive for this. So let us assuming that there are some stations which are connected, and these are N stations, like station number 1, station number 2, station number 3, up to so on. There are N stations. Okay, and every station wants to send the data with the probability P, and every station wants to send the data with the probability P. We can say let there are n stations, and every station wants to send data with a probability P. Then to do a successful transmission, only one station should transmit the data, and all other n minus one stations should not transmit the data. Okay, so if here you're representing P is a probability of transmitting the data, that A wants to transmit the data, then 1 minus P will be the probability, then one station 1 do not want to transmit the data. Okay, so you can say what is the probability of successful transmission, then therefore what is the probability for successful transmission. So this probability can be find out as P success can be find out as probability that only one station is transmitting the data, that is NC1 multiplied by other stations are not sending the data, that is 1 minus P into rest power N minus 1. Okay, here this first number NC1 into P, it is representing only one station should propagate the data, and this 1 minus P is representing that all these n minus 1 station should not propagate the data. Okay, and this we can solve it by using binomial distribution. We can solve this same by using binomial distribution. So then you know you can find what is the maximum value of successful probabilities we can get. Okay, and it's for that we have to differentiate this P success, let me write it this way. So in the previous slide we found that the P success should be equal to NC1 multiplied by P into 1 minus P raised to power N minus 1. If you want to find the maximum value of P success, then first of all differentiate this P success by P. So you can see we are going to do dP success by dP, and then you are going to equate it to 0. Okay, so generally we do maximum and minimum like this. So we are going to differentiate it. So if you are going to differentiate it, you can easily solve this formula, and you can see we can get maximum value by solving. So I'm not solving this differentiation. So after solving, we can get maximum success probability or maximum P success when the probability of sending the data is 1 by n, or successful probability of successfully sending the data is 1 by n. Therefore, P maximum or maximum probability for a successful transmission will be NC1 multiplied by 1 by n multiplied by 1 minus P raised to power N minus 1, where this P is equal to 1 by n, right? So it can also be written as NC1 multiplied by 1 by n multiplied by 1 minus 1 by n raised to power N minus 1, and this is equal to 1 by n itself. So it can be written as NC1 multiplied by 1 by n multiplied by 1 by n raised to power N minus 1. And because we are multiplying this, it is not 1 by n actually. It should be n minus 1 divided by n. It should be n minus 1 divided by n. So this can be written as, if I solve this, it can be written as 1 minus 1 by n raised to power n minus 1. So where n is the number of stations which are connected, where n is the number of stations which are connected. So this is the maximum value of p success we can get. Okay, so if we know that we have very large number of stations, that means the number of stations are very large. So we can say limit n tending to infinity, if there are very large number of station, if there are very large number of stations, so we can say limit n tending to infinity, p max should be equal to, then we should get 1 by a. So this is the probability of p success. Okay, or if this is the probability of p success, then how many times should we try before we get the first success? So then how many times should we try before getting the first success, right? So why I'm saying how many times should we try, because there's a probability for collision. Okay, therefore you can say the number of collision before any successful transmission should be roughly going to be e, because we know that if I'm saying limit, then the previous slide which we have done, limit n tending to infinity, that means if the number of stations are very large, then the maximum value of probability will be 1 by a, or you can say p max should be 1 by a. Okay, now if p max is 1 by a, then I asked you how many times should we try before getting the first success. Therefore, by Poisson distribution you can solve this value, and you can see it is 1 upon p max, which is equal to 1 upon 1 upon e, which is equal to e. Okay, therefore you can say the number of collision before any successful transmission is roughly going to be, therefore number of collisions before any successful transmission, is roughly e. Okay, so you can see if we use this value e in the efficiency formula, the efficiency which we already found out is tt upon c into 2tp plus tt plus tp. This we already done. So here c was saying what is the number of collisions we are having before any successful transmission. So if we use this value e in this formula, so you can get tt upon e multiplied by 2tp plus tt plus tp. Okay, and you already know what is the value of e. You can just substitute this value of e. So this e multiplied by 2tp will become 5.44tp. Because the value of e, you can easily find out. You can easily search on Google what is the value of e. So it is 5.44tp plus tt plus tp. Therefore, this formula will become 1 upon 1 plus 6.44tp divided by tt. 1 upon 1 plus 6.44tp divided by tp. Therefore, the efficiency you can get from this is 1 upon 1 plus 6.44tp divided by tt. If they are giving you these values, then you can find what is the maximum efficiency you can get. In case of CSMA CD. This is the maximum efficiency you can get in case of CSMA CD. Okay, now if you are going to analyze this, analyze this efficiency, you can clearly see that in case of CSMA CD, I can expand these values. So you can say efficiency the maximum efficiency should be equal to 1 upon 1 plus 6.44. TP can be written as distance upon velocity, and TP can be written as length upon bandwidth, or you can say bandwidth upon length here in this case. So you can say in case of CSMA CD, the efficiency is inversely proportional to distance. That means if the distance will increase, then efficiency will decrease. Okay, therefore you can say, therefore a CSMA CD is good, is only good for length, is only good for LANs, not for VANs, not for VAN. Why? Because efficiency is inversely proportional to distance. That means if the distance will increase, then efficiency obviously will decrease. Okay, so in LANs the distance is very less, and secondly, in case of a CSMA CD, the efficiency is directly proportional to the length of the data packet, length of data packet. And why I'm not considering the term which is bandwidth and velocity? Because bandwidth of the network is constant and velocity of the network is also constant. Okay, now let us look at the next part, that is, what is the backoff algorithm for CSMA CD? Backoff algorithm means, if for example, if two people are trying to, if two stations are involved in collision, then for how long they should wait before sending a data successfully, or before making the another try to retransmit the data. Okay, let us look at the backoff algorithm for CSMA CD.